All right, here is the final lesson when it comes to the causes of World War I, and that's going to be focusing on entangling alliances. So far we've talked about imperialism, militarism, nationalism. We've talked about positives, negatives of each one of those, but how basically when it comes to World War I, we look at the negatives as the cause for this war. Now we're going to be getting into entangling alliances, and this is a little different than the other isms, I guess you could say, that we've covered. And the idea that, well, especially with militarism, you got these huge armies building up, just massive armies in the millions. And they're starting to realize, well, maybe Germany has 1.9 million men, but Russia has 1.4 million men, but we could also get a couple more million in there if we really needed to. And when you have that many men, like, who's really going to win that war? It'd be nice if you just have overwhelming odds. Well, to get overwhelming odds, maybe it'd be better to join up with someone else. So you start seeing some major alliances forming. And just really quickly, here are the two main alliances that you need to have in your notes. The two big ones, I can say. There's a lot more, and I'm going to explain about that in a second. So you have the Triple Alliance between Germany, Austria, Hungary, and Italy. Then you have the Triple Entente, which is between Russia, Britain, and France. So basically, these kind of equaled each other out, you could say. It seems like the Triple Entente might be a bit more powerful than the Triple Alliance, at least up front, but holy cow, Germany. They're a bit of a powerhouse to carry through the other two, you could say. Although when it comes to World War I, Italy ends up joining the Triple Entente instead, but we'll get there when we get there. But when they start getting these massive alliances, they start even okay, we're still even. So what do we do? Let's go with the little countries. So everybody starts making alliances with the little countries around them, like Belgium, the newly independent Balkan states like Bulgaria, Serbia, Greece, Portugal, Spain, just everybody's starting to get alliances everywhere going, Denmark, Scandinavia. And those alliances start reaching out across the world too in some ways, like even Japan comes into them a little bit. Not fully, but in some way, shapes, and form. But through this complex net of alliances that start building up, like one of the things I wish I could do right now is I in the book, there's a nice map that shows a lot of like little alliances in place by showing little dots or diamonds on the map. And what I like to do is just kind of start connecting the dots. And all of a sudden you see this big spider web forming over the map of Europe. And the realization is that if anybody were to pull on that spider web, you pull everybody else down with it. And this is the idea of entangling alliances when it comes to World War I. Someone just needed to give a good yank to that alliance system, and just everybody would be in this big war. Now, the questions I had going along with this is, the Bellwether questions, if I remember this right, would you ever break a promise? Or basically, sorry. Are promises good to keep? Is it good to keep your promises? And then the second one was, when is it okay to break a promise? And I use these questions to kind of lead into this idea of like, well, alliances, a promise. You promise to help out in certain situations, so do you when the time comes? And the idea is if everybody does uphold their promises, again, yank on that spider web and everything just starts come tumbling down. And that is literally what happened with World War I. By the way, the big yank on the spider web was the assassination of Austria's Archduke, Franz Ferdinand, and his wife, Sophie. So, and that was at the hands of Serbian terrorists, known as the Black Hand. I'll talk about them in an upcoming lesson. But basically the deal is this. Everything was so spread out, and everybody was thinking, this is the way to get ahead. This is how we're going to get bigger and better than the other side, is we're going to team up. we hopefully are the majority partner in these alliances, but we're going to be good in the end. But through this complex system of alliances, it was realized that, oh, wow, no one would be dumb enough to pull that big spider web. So leading into World War I, there's a lot of people talking about how, because of all the alliance systems in place, that they had solved the problem of warfare. I know this sounds really dumb. Speaking in hindsight, just seems like one of the dumbest things ever. But we have solved the idea of ever going having to go to war, because no one would be dumb enough to ruin this type of peace. And for this reason, the world is just going to stay the way it is forever, because we all feel like we're good where we're at. Not everybody did, of course, but that was the idea. No one would be dumb enough to pull down this this Jenga set, I guess you could say. Who's going to pull that block out? Another way, idea like pulling on the spider web. So I hope I've painted a good picture in your mind of just how this works and how this is a cause of World War One. How in the end, it helps just bring all the blocks tumbling down. But I do like to make a little bit of a correlation to today. This is just, I don't know how to put this. I don't mean for this to get you too worried or anything like that, but this is just an interesting thing that I've seen, and I've seen other people point out. And that is the idea of globalized trade today. You know, we are so interconnected in a web of trade alliances with all these other countries in the world that we do have this thought process today that no one would be dumb enough to essentially pull on one of those threads, kind of ruin this idea that's kind of lifting the world up and bringing so much prosperity to so many different peoples and to so many different countries around the world. And to the point where we're all becoming so much more reliant on each other. But what happens when something gets busted there? That's an interesting question to be asked there. And yes, it's not the exact same thing as political alliances, and we still do have those today. But it is interesting. It's an interesting correlation to make, and that's all I'm putting out there as. So where you have this idea where people are saying this is how we're always going to have world peace is through trade alliances. And we've seen that argument made before. So anyways, I'll leave you with that, but then we won't have a lesson for a little bit because we're actually doing a simulation in class on the entangled alliances that incorporates all the causes, imperialism, militarism, nationalism, and entangling alliances. It takes a couple periods to work out and see who ends up in top in the end and who's on the bottom in the end. But once we're finished that simulation, we're going to basically jump straight into World War One and start getting into those stories. Until then, hope you have a good one.